Let's get in Dr. Subir Gokarn and talk macros. He's Director of Research at Brookings India and former Deputy Governor at the Reserve Bank of India. Sir, thanks very much. Great to have you with us here on NDTV as always. Prashant this side.
Thank you, Prashant.
It's a macro-packed week in that sense. Election results are behind us. You got trade data sometime this week. You got CPI, IIP, then you got RBI next week, Fed. So, lot to track and lot to talk about as well. But I just want to start with this taper business, Fed taper business. The common argument being made, which I've heard from many people, is that taper doesn't matter now. We are in a much better place, so taper doesn't really matter. Rupee will remain stable. It's seen the worst. Do you agree with that assessment, sir? A taper doesn't matter and it will not increase uncertainty?
I broadly, yes. I think the vulnerability that led us to the kind of turbulence we saw between May and September was essentially the very large current account deficit and the no visibility on whether it was narrowing enough to give us a buffer. Over the last quarter, clearly that has happened for a variety of reasons. The current account deficit has shrunk. We saw the second quarter numbers come in, one point something percent of GDP. But that is a dramatic shift. You could argue that not all of it is structural. In fact, much of it is perhaps temporary in nature. But for the moment, it does have an immediate impact on the supply-demand scenario for dollars. You've got to finance a current account deficit by dollars coming in. If they don't come in, the rupee is going to depreciate. And that vulnerability, I think, has reduced considerably. So as the taper materializes, which I think nobody is questioning that it will over the next few months, the level of vulnerability has gone down. So overall, the impact of that on the rupee should be much less than it was in the previous episode.
But there still will be some impact. So we will not see the rupee in a free fall. But once a small taper starts, and unless the Fed puts out a very clear timeline of how this taper, the entire unwinding of this program will take place, which is very unlikely that they will do in very clear terms, wouldn't it raise questions about how much liquidity there will be globally, how much of it India will get, and things like that? So it raises uncertainty. That's what it does.
I wouldn't agree with that assessment that we're going to be left guessing about the pace and the magnitude. I think the experience between of the last episode, the May-September period of turbulence, it holds some lessons for everybody. It holds lessons for the countries which are vulnerable to the shock, and it holds lessons for the policymakers who are going to make the decisions that might generate the shock. And I think the lesson is that with visibility, some commitments on pace and magnitude, the markets are perhaps much better equipped to absorb the shock, so it doesn't become disruptive. What caused the disruption in hindsight was exactly this, the uncertainty about how quickly it would be done and how much of an impact, how much of a withdrawal of liquidity there would be from markets in any given period. And that nervousness, I think, will not repeat because the Fed also has, I think, or is sensitive and will be sensitive to the fact that unannounced or surprise actions in this situation can be very disruptive, not just to global markets, but to their own markets as well. So stability and calibration, I think, are going to characterize the strategy. And so I think that is another reason why the overall impact will be somewhat less disruptive than we saw it in the May to September episode.
Right. Do you have a view, sir? Will we start with a small taper next week? Will we see that?
I'm not sure. I think the fiscal reconciliation is going to be a factor, and that is still 3 months away. So my sense is that that will be the starting point. It's a guess. It's an assessment.
But anyway, I guess it matters more for bond markets than than equity markets, right? I mean, I'm talking about emerging market. Emerging market.
No, I think if flight happens, if capital relocates quickly from one market to the other, it can impact all asset classes. But the point is that given that we don't have the same vulnerability, and the expectation therefore is that, you know, the reason why you have these cascading impacts is because you want to get out before the currency falls dramatically. So everybody, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy problem. When the current account is narrow, you don't have that self-fulfilling prophecy problem because people don't expect the currency to start free-falling. And that is what gives you that stability. So I think the impact across markets is not too differentiated. And so you might see some movement, but because you have this limiting factor on the current account, the prospect of a free fall is contained, it's much lower, and so people don't have this urge to rush out before the currency drops further. So I think that's really the stabilizing factor, the set of stabilizing forces that we are seeing re-emerging in certainly in the Indian context, but I think broadly across the globe, when we looked at currencies that depreciated very sharply against currencies that didn't, the differentiating factor very clearly was exactly this. It was the size of the current account deficit.
Right. Okay. Let me talk about some local things. Let's talk about this CAPEX revival sort of theme. So, you know, the government has been telling us that, well, take a look at the 300 projects which the Cabinet Committee on Infrastructure took up. 100 for 100 of those, all impediments have been cleared from the government side. Now it's up to investors to actually fund and seed them with capital. So there the government can't do very much, and you'll see progress there. The financial markets want to believe that many are holding back with their plans till you see a stable government in 2014. That well might be true. Do you believe that we are essentially at a cyclical turn, and you know, this positive, hopeful political change essentially just would act as a tailwind, so one could believe that we are headed to a better place growth wise as we get into 2014?
Well, I think I would agree with the assessment that we're at a bottom, that the situation growth-wise will perhaps not get any worse than it is today. And that is essentially the result of sort of natural buoyancy. There is agriculture, there are exports, there is capex. Let's not forget gross fixed investment, gross fixed capital formation is still above 30%, almost 33% of GDP. So that's not a bad number at all. Investment is happening. I mean, if there's a little bit of an inconsistency between what companies are saying and what the macro numbers indicate, and somebody has to reconcile this. But if you go with the macro numbers, which we're doing for growth and everything else, then the investment picture doesn't look as bleak as it's made out to be. So that's one aspect. There is growth supporting investment going on there. The question is, I think, of balance. And that's always been the constraint in the last, during the slowdown, that we're getting investment, but we're not getting it across complementary sectors to the point where every bit of capacity can be fully utilized. I think that's where the constraint is. So if these 100 projects that have been cleared are actually addressing critical bottlenecks, then I think they can have a very, very significant effect on growth as they materialize. Question is, as you said, you know, is the money coming in? Are the people who are executing these projects committing to them once the clearance is obtained? So that sort of process has to be set in motion. Now, when it comes to growth prospects beyond the elections, I think it's certainly the prospect of stability, the prospect of decisive action on many policy fronts is all part of that expectation. But what we need to see is absolutely critical bottlenecks that the economy has been faced with for the last few years being addressed. And unless we see that visibility, unless we see the system, the government as a whole committing to addressing those bottlenecks in very quick order, the expectations and the positivity could very well die down very quickly because the basic constraints remain in place. And I've been identifying three such which I think have to be the areas of focus. There are many, but these would be my top three. food. We are suffering hugely because our food economy is in such a state of distortion. Food inflation has been above 10% a year for 6 years or more, and this is completely constraining the ability of monetary policy to stimulate demand. So that's one. Infrastructure, coming back to project clearances and so on, that's one aspect of it. But bottom line is that the companies that have been executing infrastructure projects are all financially stressed. So to expect more resources to come into this sector with just the wave of a wand, I think is extremely unrealistic. We need to see some fundamental change in the whole business model and the regulatory framework. Now, who's going to address that? How's that going to be done? I think that's something that the new government has to put absolute priority on. And the third is employment. Our whole process of job creation, we've been talking about this for years. Many, many bottlenecks there, both on the demand side through job security regulations and on the supply side through the mass skilling challenges that we're facing. Of course, there are initiatives that are going on, but they have to be prioritized. They have to be put absolutely on the front burner. Now, as we see these bottlenecks being addressed, I think that's really where the growth momentum is going to come from, just as in the past. It's in the past, in our past episodes, it's the coming together of many, many changes, many reforms that brought this momentum put this momentum in place. I think that's the story we have to repeat on a different set of fronts the next time around.
So on food inflation, right, which of course is a big constraint in policy making, what's your sense? Recently, I think vegetable prices, etc., starting to come off, but it's a more structural issue, I guess, right? What's your sense? I mean, what's the trajectory we are likely to see?
Food inflation. Well, unfortunately, I think you can't argue that a phenomenon that has been in place for 6 years, good monsoon, bad monsoon, indifferent monsoon, whatever, is cyclical in nature. That, you know, something's going to happen in the environment that is going to bring it down. That's just simply misperception. So it is structural. It is the result of some very, very significant distortions within the food economy, which is impacting the choice of crops, which is impacting the allocation of resources to the crops that are actually driving this. And beyond that, all of the infrastructure issues with respect to storage and transportation and so on, all of these factors need to be addressed. There are solutions that have been tried in some places, have worked, some have not. But bottom line is that the whole structure, the whole set of incentives and the kinds of investments that need to be made have to be reoriented. And the reorientation has to be driven by one very simple factor, which is, you know, what are people eating? What are people consuming? If the farmers are not responding to those signals because they have other incentives through procurement and so on, then you're going to get this mismatch and you're going to get persistent food inflation. So I am really quite concerned that we're not seeing enough signs of this reorientation. And as I said, that is going to be an absolute priority for the next government, whoever forms it, to start to get this reorientation of incentives in place. Because otherwise, we'll have food inflation running at the levels we have seen, give or take, you know, a couple of percentage points because of good rains or bad rains, but basically at this very high level, till we have a response.
What about the other one, which is infra financing and essentially the lack of credit worthiness with many of these large or, you know, previously large conglomerates, which are pretty much struggling now to either start up existing projects which are stuck up because of lack of capital or actually embark on new projects? I mean, just not possible. How does one deal with that? Except, of course, just wait for liquidity conditions to become better, which kind of have become tighter for everyone. Because, I mean, even if you look at some of these restructuring processes, CDR, etc., which banks have sort of pushed quite a bit in many cases, many large cases, you know, the focus is just to recover loans. I mean, they don't care about the viability of the company and what they can do after that. I mean, they're just sort of interested in getting in recoveries. So what can be done, sir?
Well, I think we have to revisit the premises of the PPP model itself try and understand what went wrong, both on the private side in terms of companies bidding for projects, costing them, making revenue projections that clearly in many cases have not materialized, not panned out, and the way they finance these projects, the debt equity, the leverage strategies that they've adopted. And on the other side, what has the government done in terms of meeting its commitments, the public part of the equation? Has it been time-bound in its clearances? Has it provided policy clarity? Has it provided adequate regulatory support for these projects, given that they're all in some state of regulatory control? Now, all of these questions, I think, all these factors have contributed to the eroded viability of infrastructure projects. The private side has not delivered on its commitment or has made some errors of judgment, and the public side has not delivered on the commitments that it made, as a result of which the cost configuration, the cost picture of these projects has gone completely haywire. So this model needs to be reworked. I don't think it's a matter of just, you know, offering a few simple aphorisms to do that. It is essentially a redesigning issue that has to be addressed. And who's going to play the role here? Is it going to be more state-oriented? That may mean that may work in some sectors. Do we need a different kind of financing structure, which will help, which will aid more efficient execution and less risk, less vulnerability? That's to be developed on the private side. I don't think there's a uniform solution sector by for all sectors. We've got to, I think, have a basic framework where both sides' responsibilities are laid out a little more clearly, and then sort of package them as appropriate for each sector. So it is a long haul issue. It's not something that is going to be solved overnight. But there we need, I think, a very, very conscious strategy on how to redesign the whole infrastructure model. And what are the new roles and responsibilities of the various stakeholders, the private sector and the public sector? But this is a complex issue, and we've got to address it very quickly, because not only is it hampering growth in terms of the gap just widening day by day, but it's also spilling over heavily into the financial sector, as you've just indicated.
Absolutely. I think we got essentially some recommendations as far as the roads sector is concerned recently, but there is a lot more through the spectrum there. So, just to come back to here and now, RBI policy next week, what would you expect? Would you expect them not to raise rates? I mean, it's a question which you do get asked quite a bit, but it seems like, and you'll get the CPI numbers before that and all of that, the RBI will watch it. But what's your sense?
Well, I think the message coming from the RBI is the basic trend of inflation is going to be the dominant factor. So let's wait for the number and take a call on that. Now, I don't expect, having said that, I don't expect the number to be very different from what it was or what it's been over the last few months. I think the pressure from food is still very, very much there. Even the core inflation number that is being referred to now on the CPI is still very high. It was 8.1 or so last month, and if it's around that rate, obviously there is really no room from the perspective of the framework that is being put in place, that is, you know, the CPI as the policy benchmark, to reduce rates. Whether increase or not, I think is an open question. I don't think I have enough basis to make a firm prediction there.
Got that, sir. It's always a pleasure hearing your thoughts. Thanks very much for coming on NDTV. Appreciate you. Appreciate your time, sir. Thank you. Thanks again. All right. So, 28 points off on the Nifty now. Just what's happening as far as the stock market is concerned, and the rupee is kind of flattish. We're going to take a very quick break. We're back in two more on what's happening in a bit more detail on the other side.